Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Beneath the Lake, Crystal Lake Publishing's official video cast. I am your host, Todd Kiesling, and we have a very special episode lined up for you today. We are talking with some wonderful authors. Kya Shore and Linda Addison are joining me today to talk about Women in Horror Month, because that's what February is. So, unfortunately, Stephanie Witowicz could not join us today because she had a last-minute vet emergency, so we're going to hope, cross our fingers and hope their little puppy is all right. And with that said, I'm going to shut up and let Kya and Linda introduce themselves. So, ladies, thank you for joining me.
Hi, happy to be here.
Thank you for having me.
No problem.
All right, why don't you go first? You talk about yourself first.
Okay, I'm Kya Shore. I'm 22 years old, and I've been writing horror since I was 13 and reading it ever since I can remember. So Women in Horror Month is probably one of my favorite months because it gives me an excuse to just read every single day.
That's awesome.
And I'm Linda Addison. I pretty much read and write horror all the time. I'm actually doing more science fiction lately. I'm working on a science fiction project right now. But I have written and published a lot of things. You're going to give your age? I'm going to give my age. I'm 64. So been doing this a long time, too. Making up stories since I was 12 or something ridiculous. Got a lot of stuff in print. Have 4 Bram Stokers. It's Women in Horror Month and Black History Month. I'm like a double threat. What can I tell you?
Well, I must say, you don't look 64. You look younger.
Wow, so thank you. That was the right thing to say.
You're very, very welcome. See, that's an old Kiesling charm.
Working and winning.
So, how are you guys doing? Is it a good day? You got having, you know, Linda, I know you're at a conference BossCon. Right now. BossCon. Right,
yeah.
Kya?
I'm having a great day. I got here 2 days ago. The only thing that makes me take a double take is I look out the window and there's snow. I moved from New York to Arizona, so there would be no snow in my life. And there's snow. So
oh, wow.
I'm like, okay, I'm not going outside the hotel until I get on the plane, so. But I'm having a great time. They're keeping me busy and meeting new writers, seeing some old friends. It's been a ball.
That's awesome. Kya, how about you? How you doing?
I'm having a great day so far. Unseasonably warm here in Virginia, so soaking up some sun while I can.
Yeah, same here in Pennsylvania. So we're all East Coasters at the moment and having a really odd February.
Yes.
So, it's Women in Horror Month, and I'm going to ask the most obvious and cliched question ever, because I'm woefully unprepared for this, as always. Women in Horror Month, what does it mean to you?
Kya, you want to start or shall I? I don't care.
You can go ahead.
Okay. When this was created, and I don't know that it was that long ago, actually, not that many years ago that this Women in Horror Month came into existence, I thought this is pretty cool because in general, in genre writing, women writers is kind of a new phenomenon. For me, like, okay, 64, right? I've been writing for 40 years. Like, I remember 40 years ago actually considering changing my name so that no one would know I was a girl. And I was talked out of that by Nancy Kress, who's a, you know, well-published, awarded science fiction writer. And her basic thing was, if you write well enough, it shouldn't matter that your name is Linda. I was concerned that people would see the story, and if I didn't explicitly say it's a girl or boy, they would assume it was. Anyway, I digress. I mean, the point being that it is good, I think, to have these times where we acknowledge and sort of make people pay attention to something that's maybe outside their norm. Mm-hmm. So maybe outside the normal world, people don't think, oh, there's there's so many women writing horror. So I like this sort of telescoping in just for a period of time, and hopefully it will feed over the year to bring people into reading other people. Same thing with Black History Month, which is at the same month. And as I said, I'm sort of a double threat. I like the fact that, you know, that we have a Black History Month. I also hope that in general, it creates a whole year of interest in, you know, Black history. So, you know, I think there's a lot to be said for that.
That's a great answer. Thank you.
That is a great answer. So for me, it's an excuse to read more, to create a new to-read list, because I have an ongoing to-read list that stacks up every month, and so I can look at it and I could be like, okay, great, what other books can I look forward to? Which books are coming out this month? What are my friends talking about? And I think it really introduces a lot of people to new women in horror that they're not only going to read in February, but through the whole year. So it's just kind of a chance to explore the genre deeper, and I like that.
Also, yeah. A good answer. Thank you. So, Linda, something that you said, I'm going to kind of use that as a talking point about how it's an opportunity to kind of get people to maybe read authors they normally wouldn't, and, you know, kind of step outside of their comfort zone in some ways. And we were talking about this before I clicked record on the show. I was and I'm gonna own up to this. I was trying to list out some of the women writers that I've read, and I'm ashamed to say that it's a really short list. And I think, you know, Linda, what you said specifically, that's exactly what, you know, maybe Women in Horror Month is one of the intended things, is to get people to become more aware of excellent fiction that's out there. And Linda, are you still with us?
I am, and I don't know what just happened. My picture went away. Here I am. Oh, no, okay. That's not it.
You're there. Uh-oh. We lost Linda. I think her internet.
Oh, no.
That happens with Google sometimes if the connection is kind of spotty. There she is.
I know, but my video, do you see me moving? Because I don't. I see a picture.
No, it may be related to your hotel Wi-Fi. If the connection is kind of slow, it'll just kick over to audio only.
Oh, no.
It's okay. We still have you. That's what matters.
Oh, there, I'm back.
Okay, welcome back. It is
the hotel's, yeah, okay.
So, you know, one of the, as I was saying, I mean, my list is incredibly short, and I, you know, kind of have been watching a lot of the Women in Horror Month posts, especially that the HWA has been doing, like a daily feature and everything. And I've kind of been just keeping an eye on that every day and just adding names to a list and stuff I want to check out. Like, I was going to talk about Stephanie's new book, The Eighth, because that's on my list. I haven't had a chance to read it, but, you know, Kya, to your point, an ever-growing and revolving reading list. I think every writer in the world has one of those. You know, Damian Angelica Walters, Michelle Gordon, Melinda, I think it's Layson, the Sisters of Slaughter, they call them. Linda, your work, Mercedes Yardley, Margaret Atwood, Gemma Files. One of my favorites, actually, is it's kind of like what you said earlier, Linda, about how you were considering writing under a pseudonym of a guy's name, James Tiptree Jr., or Alice Sheldon, I believe her real name was. Screwfly, yeah. Solution is one of my all-time favorite short stories. I mean, and it's incredible. So, you know, what are, I guess, in this long digression is intended to segue to my next question is, like, who are some of your favorite, you know, women writers?
My list, you know, as I said, I know I was going to sort of not remember anyone. So I'm just going to tell people to go look at all the women in horror, daily things have been coming up from HWA, every single one of them. Eden Royce has also been doing a daily one. You can find a link on my website where she highlights a different woman each day. I can't even begin to tell you. I will say this much, and that is because of this coming together of women in horror and Black history. One of the projects that I worked on, it actually has a book launch next weekend in Atlanta, Sycorax's Daughter. Sorry for saying it wrong. I should know better. I was one of the editors on the book. Is really a collection of horror, poetry, and fiction by Black women. And I know for some people, they're like, wow, are there that many that you can do an anthology? And, you know, the search for names was part of the interesting part of the experience. We actually, you know, myself and the two other editors, Kenitra Brooks and Susanna Morris, went to a widespread to find people because we invited people for the most part, although we did put out a general thing, to find women who wrote anything that was edgy, that was horror, that was, you know, sometimes someone saw someone performing a poem in a club and passed their name to us. So again, I love the idea of this experimentation. So the names of people in the book that I do adore and everyone knows already, Sanana Reeve Du, Crystal Connor, who has done some wonderful work and has continued to create some wonderful work. There's just a whole list of names there that people know, and a lot of names that people don't know. And that's what I love about this kind of highlighting of things. A good two-thirds of them, I have read their work. And so putting it into this anthology, this is all, for the most part, new work. So it's really very exciting. I can't even begin to give you a list. There's just too many.
That's fine. Totally fair. I get it. So you did say to go check out your website, though, regarding that thing that you're editing. So
yes,
folks who are watching, please go check out Linda's website.
Right. It's LindaAddisonPoet.com. And then at the top, you can see everyone that's in the book. You can see the link for the book launch. It's available now. And why Linda Addison Poet is because there is another Linda Addison out there in the world, but she's a lawyer and she doesn't look like this. So you're going to know immediately who you got.
You're the only Linda Addison in my book, as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you, Todd.
Kya, how about you?
So to kind of echo what Linda said, there's lots of websites out there that, you know, feature daily stuff like HWA. I also know that Ginger Nuts of Horror is doing a whole section on Women in Horror Month. There's the official Women in Horror Month Twitter account, which retweets articles from all over, websites you've never heard of, which is really awesome. You know, there's just so many women in horror out there, and it's crazy because I'll come across somebody and I'll read their work and I'll be like, how have I never heard of them before? So it's a really fun time. Some of my personal favorites would definitely be Lisa Morton, Rena Mason. There's just so many I couldn't list.
Yeah, I'm going to go with her with those two names for sure. And like I said, there's just so many more. I love Lisa's work also, yeah.
I already mentioned, you know, Alice Sheldon, a.k.a. James Tiptree Jr., but, I gotta give a shout-out to my sister from another mother, I should say, Mercedes Yardley. She's one of my best friends, and I love her work.
Yeah, she's so good.
Yeah, mm-hmm. She really is. Another book that I read last year that I absolutely loved was Experimental Film by Gemma Files. And I think I'm pronouncing her name correctly, Gemma. I hope I am, if Gemma or Gemma.
I apologize. Well, Gemma, but you know, I could do it wrong too. But I love her work. She was such a good writer.
Yeah, Experimental Film was incredible. I loved it.
I want to mention one other name just as a highlight because it really it's like a skipping stone of my career, and that is Cherie Renee Thomas is in Sycorax's Daughter, but she also created Dark Matter. She was the editor of Dark Matter 1, so many years ago, and I was in that anthology. And it, and I'm hoping like she'll be the good luck charm in this one, in the sense that when Dark Matter 1 came out, it was the same idea. It was science fiction, fantasy, and horror by black writers, not just women. And what it did is it created interest in a lot of writers that people didn't know about, including myself, over the years. So I'm hoping she's going to be a good luck charm being in this book. That will hopefully bring people to look at some of this, the work here, and say, oh, I want to go read more about these writers.
That's awesome. Thank you. So I am going to be going back through this because I have to edit out the lead-ins and stuff, but I'll be going back through this and writing some of these names down so I can check them out. Add to my list here of ladies that I need to read more of. And eventually, I'm sure there's going to be just all the way down the page.
There is for me always. It's not like I get to read them all either. I'm always discovering new writers. I love it.
Yeah, I think that's kind of our gift and our curse in a lot of ways. Is, you know, when you start getting to know your peers, you're always going to have new stuff to read, even before it's out. But that's on top of this other stuff that you had already planned on reading, and it's just, you're never going to catch up. It's impossible.
It's like the TBD list, the to-be-done list. You're never going to empty it, so don't even try.
Yeah, I've got, I don't know if you can tell, I actually have a stack of books right there next to my severed foot. There's a stack of books right there that I have to... Those are actually my Nikon books. I got... You know, I spent way too much money at Nikon this past summer, and I haven't even touched them. I just, had a million other books in my bedroom next to my bed. So, yeah.
All have these piles. I mean, the ones that we know and love... We buy their book, I do, and then it becomes on the pile of books, that I know that I need to read. So, yeah.
The life of being a writer and a reader. So, speaking of Nikon, I got an off-the-cuff question for you. I had a lot of good experiences there this past summer. Linda, I know you're a Nikon veteran. You've been there. They recognized you this past summer for that.
Yeah, they made me a legend.
I think that was one of my favorite parts when they were recognizing you for that, and they said something. I forget who it was that was doing the talking. It might have been Jeff Strand. I don't know. I can't recall which night it was. But
it was Jeff and one other person. Don't get me started. I'm a writer, not a memorist. I'm just going
to
say that.
Oh, no, it's fine. But I was standing close to the door. They recognized you, and they were doing the roast. It was the night of the roast. And they recognized you, and they said... Jeff said that, there's nothing bad we can say about Linda. And you stood up, and you went, "Hey! Fuck you."
No, I think also it was like, "And I will fucking cut you if you do say something bad." Which is just, that's my tagline at Nikon. When they did my roast, it was about the funniest thing ever, because I forget who was there that wanted them to say bad things about me, and I was sitting up there being roasted. I turned to them and I said, "Well, obviously everyone but you wants to live."
That's great. Oh man, that was my first conference experience, actually. So I look forward to
it. BossCon is very special. It's so different. I mean, BossCon, you see them all dressed up. It's a whole different kind of thing. Nikon is t-shirts, jeans, and a lot of F-bombs. That's what you into. And beer and drinking and talking.
Yeah, that's right up my alley. So I'm going back. So
yeah. To me, the best thing is I've gone for 22 years. I will not miss it if I have anything to say about it. But the very first one, I had a chance to sit down with beer and talk to Peter Straub about characterization. I mean, stop it. Are you kidding? Wow. There was no way I was not going back to that convention.
Yeah, seriously. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's cool.
Kya, did you have a favorite Nikon experience or memory to share?
There's so many. Uh-huh. I think just like the environment and being chill with everybody, being able to just walk around and talk to whoever, and it wasn't like, you know, well, these are the elite authors and, you know, they're featured on the panels and then there's everyone else. It's just like everyone was chilling and talking about the craft and learning from each other, and it was amazing.
Yeah, I will second that. It's not at all what I expected it would be. And I'm not trying to turn this into a Nikon commercial or anything, but it was so much fun.
Ah, come on, we can do that. Although, I think, they tap out at 200 people. It's not like, you know, here there's like hundreds of people here. They tap out at 200, so if you went in, you got to get in there.
Yeah. For me, I think that the biggest realization was that, you know, I'm walking around and I'm seeing these authors that I've, you know, been aware of for years, and you know, they're pretty high up on the, you know, the genre totem pole, and I'm like, oh my god, that's so and so, that's Jeff Strand, that's Bracken McLeod, that's Chris Golden, oh my god. And then it was the realization that they're people just like me, doing this, you know, every day.
That's the joy of that small convention. It brings together, you know, authors, agents, publishers, fans, and you know, it's so small and laid back. You can just sit and talk, like, you know, it's a wonderful time.
Yeah, it was. I had a blast. So, steering this back on course, I kind of had to gush over Nikon a little bit. Sorry, Kya. We were talking before we went, live, I should say. You actually have been doing this for a long time. You started when you were 13, and you've been published. You have your own press as well. Tell us a little bit about that, because I think that's incredible.
Well, yeah. I just kind of got into it when I was 13, and I didn't really think a lot of it. I started writing one night because I was bored and I'd read all the books on my bookshelf and I didn't get to go to the library until the next day. So I'm like, I'll just make something up. So I wrote a story and then I couldn't stop. And my friends all loved the story. They're like, you have to write more. We have to tell it around the campfire, because during the summer they would come and we would all sit around a campfire and tell stories. So it just kind of went from there, and I was very fortunate to have a lot of support from my parents and my friends and the librarian. He would read and critique my work, and he put together like a whole teen writers workshop for us at the library every week, and would get college professors and best-selling authors to come in and teach us the craft. Mm-hmm. So it's
awesome.
It was amazing. And then I started up my own press, and we publish a yearly anthology of horror stories written by kids ages 6 through 18, because they really need an outlet to follow their dreams and express their creativity, and they might not be ready to be published by a big publisher or, you know, a small press, but they need something. So I created the anthology.
That is awesome. I think
that's so fantastic. Wow.
Is that, I think that especially for a lot of young writers who are hoping to kind of break into, you know, making it their career or pursuing it, that first publication, regardless of whether you're getting paid or what, you need that. It's that early validation that says, you know what, kid, you got it. Here you go. Keep going.
It's such an important thing. I mean, I think it's wonderful, because you need, as you said, that, and the fact that having some moment where someone says, I honor the fact that you're doing this thing, that you're putting your heart and your soul into creating something, and they're not judging it necessarily, saying this, that, or the other, just that. And seeing it in print. I mean, the first time I saw my name in print, I was like, done. And it was a mimeograph newsletter. My first publication. I couldn't have been more happy if I'd won like the Oscars. So
That
it's really important work.
is important. So I have to
Thank
commend you, Kaya, for that. I think that's a great thing that you're doing. So
you.
what is the name of the anthology?
Dreams Come True, Stories for the Campfire.
That's perfect.
You.
So, do you work with libraries and stuff like that, or to get the kids involved and interested in it or anything?
Absolutely. I've gone around to several different libraries in my area and in the DC area, introducing myself, asking if they have a writing group for teens or kids. I offer to come speak to them, and I always invite them to submit to the anthology. I'm putting together a writing course for teenagers that focuses on the importance of plot and how to craft a beginning, a middle, and an end, and I want to go around to libraries and teach it to them for free, of course, and then have them submit whatever they write in the class to the anthology. So,
That is awesome.
amazing. Amazing. Thank you.
Wow. I love that. I love that you're doing that for, for the kids, for the community. And I'm a little envious that I didn't think of it. So
Well, it's
no, it's
never too
great.
late. I hope
Truly.
that other publishers follow in my footsteps and have anthologies like this and create more small presses for kids.
I mean,
That's
it's
great.
the thing is, again, I was mentored by teachers and so forth coming up in ways that I would not be here speaking with you now if I had not had those wonderful jewel points along the way. And I think I know you're not a young writer because you've been writing so long, but to be able to realize how important it is to give that back, everyone can do that. There's never, as you said, it's never too late to reach out and say to someone, oh, hey, here's something. That recognition is worth its weight in gold.
I agree. So, I'm gonna ask another off-the-cuff question. And are you ready?
I'm
I'm
always
ready.
ready.
Out of your both of your various publications and whatnot, could you pick if you had to say, for someone who's never read any of your work whatsoever? What's the one thing you would point them to first and say, this is probably best representative of what, my work is about? And go.
It's a race, and we're both too polite to try to run.
No, it's okay.
Okay, I'll start because still working over my shyness from childhood. I would say probably one of the later collections that I have now, How to Recognize a Demon Has Become Your Friend, because it's designed as a poem, a story, a poem, a story. And it's science fiction, fantasy, and horror. And that's one that I speak to people about, unless they're totally poetry freak geeks, because then I've got books that are just poetry, because it's a nice mix of all of those things. So it's a good way to jump in.
Okay.
Awesome.
Kaya.
A lot of my novels are unpublished right now because I am editing them again. I made a lot of mistakes as a teenager
It
because we are
happens.
all learning and growing.
Yeah.
But my favorite work that I always recommend people start with is this young adult novel that I wrote called Sly Darkness. And I really enjoy it because the characters, they were loosely based on my friends, with this horror thrown in there. And I just really like the dynamic of how they all communicate together and learn about each other. So that's probably the most accurate representation of my work.
Awesome. Yeah, I when I was stalking both of you on Amazon earlier, I saw some of your titles were not available, which made me sad because I typically with my other guest on the show, I'll try to pick up at least, one of their books so that I can, become more familiar if I haven't read any of their stuff already. So when may we see them come back in print?
I'm hoping this summer. So okay. I'm just trying to get some of the grammatical errors out of there and delete some adverbs. I had a problem with that.
Understood. I think we all.
I'm always rewriting against my passive voice problem when I rewrite. It's all about, we're going to just do one rewrite and get rid of passive voice, Linda, okay?
Yep. Yeah. I have the same problem.
Adverbs and passive voice, I both fully admit I am totally guilty of that as well. For me, I think it's more just like toning back the adverbs a little bit, knowing when to use them rather than using them all the time, being a bit more selective. Mm-hmm. And passive voice, again, that's my editor Amelia, she likes to beat me up over passive voice all the time.
Yeah, I'm really lucky. I have a writers group in New York, Circles in the Hair, that I've been part of since 1990. And literally, they're a good chunk of the reason why I've been published and gotten any awards, because they read, we read each other's work, but they read over mine, and you couldn't get a better group of editors if you tried. And I also try to learn. I mean, I'm still learning to write, increase the skill, but need to have that feedback from me. I need it anyway.
Yeah, that's one thing I totally agree with, is that you're always growing as a writer. I mean, you're definitely, you're always going to be seeking to improve somehow, even when you're getting amazing reviews and people are saying incredible things about your work. It's like you're always going to look at it and say, well, I could have done this better. And I think that's the curse of the artist in general.
Yeah, well, kudos to Kya for going back and redoing some of that work. I mean, yeah. If you really feel so driven. I mean, my first book, Animate Objects, I used to cringe when I went back and read it. I was like, oh my God. And that was the best I could do at the time. Okay. But, I made peace with it. But, sometimes, and I know it's good for people to be able to do what Kaya's doing now. So that's, to be able to go back and bring it to the level of where you've learned, which is nice.
Absolutely. Yeah, Kya, I myself will be doing this similar thing with my first novel. This is the 10th anniversary. So I'm hoping to do a 10th anniversary edition of it, and I got to go back through it. And I'm not looking forward to it, because I don't want to look at all the dumb shit I did when I was younger.
Oh, it's hard. I'll be going through it. I'm like, what was I thinking?
You were thinking the best you could then. This is what I always tell myself. Like, okay, this was really the best I could do at that time.
So, what? We're coming up on close to an hour, so. What I will say now is, let's tell everybody, what's next. What's next for Linda? What's next for Kya?
Well, one of the things I mentioned, that the book launches next weekend in Atlanta. You can read the details on my website for Sycorax's Daughters, which is being published by Cedar Grove Books. A wonderful launch party for its beautiful book. It's 26 authors, 30 some poems, stories, future, past, present. I mean, it's just a wide quilt of wonderful stories written by Black women, and it's a real horror written by Black women, and it's a real wonderful mix of things. The voices are all very distinct, so I'm excited about that. I'm also working on a video project with Jamal Hodge, H-O-D-G-E, where he's taken, this is kind of miraculous to me, he's taken one of my poems, One Night Stand, and he's turned it into a little film. I've read the script, and he's done it like a magic of making a real story out of it with real characters and everything. And we're going to be doing a fun crowdfunding situation coming up soon, so everyone's going to hear about that. Start putting money in your bank now for it. If you got $5 million, that's fine, but I'm asking for $5 to start with. Let's go somewhere with this.
I'm pretty sure I can swing $5. That's awesome. Kaya, how about you?
Well, right now I'm getting together the final details for the second Dreams Come True anthology. I'm gonna open up submissions in the summertime because that way, kids don't have so much homework in school, so they can focus on writing a story for it. And I've gotten into marketing, and I'm a marketer. It's like my day job. So I am putting together a course that I want to offer to horror authors specifically on how to market their books in the ever-changing internet and social media world. So I'm excited about that one.
That's
I
awesome.
would take that course.
It'll be available soon.
Awesome. I wanted to just add something, reminded me by what the wonderful work Kaya has been doing, and that is that HWA has just started a thing. They're working with libraries, and they're also setting up a scholarship thing for young writers, which is very
Awesome.
exciting. I'm really happy about that.
That's right. I remember reading something about that.
Yeah.
That's
They're going
right.
to be giving out scholarships to young writers writing horror, so it'll be cool.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
All right. Well, why don't you tell everyone where we can find you online?
Well,
Website
as
or
I said,
anything?
my site, lindaaddisonpoet.com, it has all kinds of things about events, where I'm at, new things that are going to be coming out. And I do daily life poems on Twitter, so you can find me on there. And I feed those to Facebook. I've been doing those for over a year now, so.
Cool.
And I am on Facebook and Twitter. You can also find me at kayashore.com. So.
Well, Kaya, Linda, it has been an absolute pleasure talking to you both today, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. And
Thank you.
no problem. And folks, thank you for tuning in and watching this episode of Beneath the Lake, Crystal Lake Publishing's official video cast. I am your host, Todd Kiesling, and I think I should probably mention that I also have a book out, because if I don't, then Joe will kill me.
Yeah, Todd, what's up with that?
What's up with that? I know, seriously. The book is called The Final Reconciliation. It is out now from Crystal Lake Publishing. It is a King in Yellow story about a progressive death metal band, and Cemetery Dance loved it. So, you can go buy that. It is for sale. So please do, and leave a review. That would be awesome. And on that note, I'm going to stop embarrassing myself and stop recording. So thanks for watching, folks.